The following preview is of a graphic audio production rated for mature audiences due to scenes of intense violence and sexual situations.
Available now from Graphic Audio.
Deunero.
Yes, Deunero. Master Deunero.
You are discredited. The church has seen the truth.
Your truth.
All the world knows the truth of Avalyn now, and of Giuseppe, who is queen.
All the world believes the lies, but I will teach them the truth. Yes, I shall.
Donovan Dyer! Elbrian, Nightbird, Father, I would do battle with you. Come forth and face me.
I have just come from Abbot Owan. And from the kitchens of Castle Ursel before that. Was it not enough for you to keep me barren? Did you have to go after my very life in addition?
You have been poisoning my food!
You speak nonsense! You do not know!
I know! And so also will King Danube, unless...
Unless?
Unless Constance Pimplebury takes her leave of Castle Ursel.
My king! Do you wish to take part in our games?
I do, my king!
And what is your name and title?
I am Time Aquilic of Hunt the Bear.
I have murdered! The Queen has slain me!
This is insanity!
Don't miss the shocking conclusion of the Demon War Saga Book 5, Ascendance, Part 2. Available now. In graphic audio.
The maelstrom has begun.
And now for our feature presentation.
Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Elmer Kelton's Texas Rangers series. Performed by Terence Aselford, Danny Gavigan, Joe Brack, Eric Messner, Tim Getman, David Coyne, Scott McCormick, Andy Clemence, Tim Carlin, James Konicek, Drew Kopas, Lily Beacon, M.B. Van Dorn, Ken Jackson, Dylan Lynch, Elizabeth Jernigan, Thomas Penny, Nanette Savard, Johann Dettweiler, Michael Glenn, Karen Novak, Richard Rowan, Katie Foster, Michael John Casey, James Lewis, Casey Platt, Jeff Allin, Tony Nam, and Mort Shelby. Texas Rangers number 6, Jericho's Road. After several years as a Texas Ranger, Andy Pickard concluded that the average criminal he dealt with was about as intelligent as a jackrabbit. That said, even a dullard could pull a trigger and hurt somebody. A case in point was the reluctant prisoner trudging along 10 paces ahead of Andy.
It ain't fair. You're a young man, barely growed, but you're riding my horse and making me walk.
You shot mine.
Well, I didn't mean to.
I know, you were shooting at me.
No. Well, how much further we got to go?
A ways yet. It'll give you time to consider changing your occupation.
Deuce Scoggins had earned a reputation as a second-rate horse thief who couldn't tell a mare from a gelding and knew no better than to peddle them in the first town he came to after he stole them. His trail had led Andy across several counties along the Colorado River, but a string of angry victims had made the path easy to follow. Confronted, Deuce had fired one shot in panic, killing Andy's horse. He then threw his hands up and begged for mercy. Andy had made him strip the saddle, bridle, and blanket from the dead animal and transfer them to his own.
Where'd you get this horse, Deuce?
I won him in a poker game? Honest.
Sure. Did you ever think about getting a job and making an honest living?
Work? I tried once, Ain't much I can do good enough that anybody will pay me for it.
Doesn't look like you're good enough at horse thieving to be paid much either.
Deuce's sweat-streaked shirt was much too large, loosely draped over thin shoulders, the grime-edged cuffs almost covering his dirty hands. He had probably lifted it from somebody's clothesline.
Even an Indian would treat a man better than this.
You don't know Indians, Deuce. Be glad you don't know them. They'd make it a mighty short acquaintance.
The afternoon was almost done when they rounded the bend in the wagon road and saw the crossroads town ahead. Its largest buildings were a courthouse, a new jail, and a church.
I heard their old jailhouse got burned down. It wasn't no nice place. I was in it once.
Too bad you didn't go in the church instead, Deuce.
Well, can't you take these handcuffs off before we hit town? It's embarrassing to let people see me this way.
A little embarrassment might be good for you. There was a time when they would have necked you to a tree limb. As it is, they'll likely just send you to the penitentiary.
You've already been there. It ought to be against the law to put a man in a hellhole like that.
Sheriff Tom Blessing stood in the doorway of the red brick jail. Recognizing Andy, he grinned broadly and raised his big right hand in greeting. He looked more like a farmer than a lawman, for indeed he was a farmer first. Despite his years, he still had the muscled body of a blacksmith.
Bringing me a guest, Andy.
I hated for your new jailhouse to stand empty. The taxpayers have put a big investment in it. Reckon Deuce can have a stay?
Sure. Come on in here, Deuce. I got a nice cell with your name on it, all swept out and waiting for you.
Well, I'm hungry, and I'm thirsty, and this ranger has worn my feet down plumb to the bone.
Write a letter to the governor.
Tom led Deuce past barred iron doors and pointed him to a cell.
I'll bring you a bucket of water directly, Deuce. There's a slop jar under the cot. Make yourself at home.
He winked at Andy, walking into the jail. Deuce was wanted in several counties, but Andy had brought him here because this was the nearest jail, and the sun was almost down. He didn't care to risk camping with a prisoner on the trail. Here he could get a good night's sleep without worrying that Deuce might try to escape. Tom would keep the horse thief in custody until the several counties that wanted him sorted out their priorities.
Did he give you any trouble, Andy?
Not after he shot my horse. He went to blubbering. Thought I was fixing to kill him. I let him keep on thinking so till I got the cuffs on him.
Some rangers would have shot him for killing their horse. Whose is that you're riding?
No telling. Somebody's probably looking for him.
I'll check my notices. I got a message for you somewhere. Here it is. Your captain sent a wire to all the sheriffs around here, not knowing just where you turn up. Want you to report to him.
Andy felt uneasy, wondering what the captain might want. Maybe the state's finances had turned tight again, and the ranger force was being trimmed. It had happened often before. His several years of service were no guarantee that he would escape the next cut.
Reckon the telegraph office is still open?
I expect so. The operator's not anxious to go home of an evening. His wife's been burning the beans lately on account of him being a sorry poker player.
In the telegraph office, Andy had written a brief message on paper, reporting the capture of Deuce Scoggins. He read it over and penciled out every word it could spare. The state disliked paying for long messages, so ranger reports tended to be spare on detail.
Finished?
If there's a reply, I'll be staying the night at the jail.
I'll fetch it over as soon as it comes.
Andy watched the operator tap out the message, marveling at the progress he had seen in just the few years he had been a member of the Rangers. It seemed unreal that he could write a few lines here and know they'd be received miles away in an instant. The telegraph had done much to tighten up law enforcement across Texas. Word of a fugitive could race past him and alert officers to intercept him down the road. Andy couldn't imagine how it might ever get much better than that. Back at the jail, Andy found Tom standing in front of the wood stove.
I'm eating some leftover beans and cornbread for the prisoner, but I expect you'll want something better. I'll go with you down to the eating joint as soon as I get Deuce taken care of.
Tom had a farm a few miles out of town, but he often spent the night in the jail rather than make the ride twice, once out and then back in the morning.
If it wasn't already so late, I'd ride out and pay a visit to Rusty Shannon. Maybe I'll do it tomorrow.
I used to worry a right smart about Rusty. He pined away for a long time after Josie Monahan died. He's fared some better since he made up his mind to marry her sister Alice. She's been like a tonic to him.
He deserves a run of good luck for a change. He had enough bad to do for a lifetime.
Rusty had been like a brother to the orphaned Andy, teaching, counseling, providing a benchmark when Andy seemed about to lose his way.
If it wasn't for Rusty, I don't know where I'd be now. In jail, like as not. Or dead.
You never were that bad of a kid. All you needed was guidance.
Andy had been taken by Comanche raiders when he was a small boy. They raised him until he fell back into Texan hands at about the time his voice started to change. His reintroduction to the white man's world had exposed him to many pitfalls. Even now, in his mid-20s, he sometimes found himself facing situations where the choice was difficult to make. He had always leaned heavily on Rusty's advice. When Rusty wasn't around, he tried to visualize what Rusty would do.
Too bad Deuce Scoggins didn't have somebody like Rusty to point the way for him when he was young.
Might not have made any difference. There's some people that nobody can help. They got no skill and no trade. They're too shiftless for honest work, and every time they come to a fork in the road, they turn the wrong direction. I've seen a lot like Deuce, drifting to God knows where. I've got to watch myself so I don't get to thinking the whole world is that way. You've been a ranger a good while now. You ever find yourself getting cynical?
Cynical? I still find there's more good folks than bad ones. If I try, I can even feel a little sorry for Deuce.
Whoa, don't tell him so. It might encourage him to get worse.
The telegraph operator found Andy sitting with Tom at a table in the restaurant.
Got a reply to your message. Thought you'd want to see it right away.
Andy read the paper slowly. Rusty had been more successful in teaching him about farming and being a ranger than about reading and writing.
Any answer?
Just say, we'll comply.
The operator picked a biscuit up from the table and then went out the door.
New orders, Andy?
Captain says our company is being cut again. Says headquarters in Austin wants to reassign me to the Mexican border.
If you've ever thought about resigning, this might be the time. A man can get killed down there.
A man can get killed anywhere. Deuce might have shot me if he hadn't hit my horse instead.
But it's like a holy war along the Rio Grande. They've been that way since the Battle of the Alamo, and doesn't show any sign it's fixing to change. You're automatically somebody's enemy on sight. It just depends on how light or dark your face is.
Sounds like the Indian Wars.
The Indian Wars are over. This one's not. Do you speak any Mexican?
Just a few cuss words I picked up.
You'll have every chance to use them, and you'll probably pick up a bunch more.
Andy was ready to leave town the next morning. Because the horse he had taken from Deuce was undoubtedly stolen, he'd left it in Tom's custody and bought one at the livery barn. Rangers were obliged to furnish their own horses, but the state was supposed to pay for one killed in the line of duty. Andy trusted that he would be reimbursed. If not, he'd still be able to eat, though it might be a while before he could afford a new hat or a pair of boots.
Sorry I couldn't provide you with a feather bed, Andy. That jail cot can be about as hard as a cement floor.
Yeah, at least the price was right.
I'll ride with you as far as Shanty's farm. Then I'll be cutting off and going home.
I'm glad for the company.
If they send you by San Antonio, be sure to go and visit the Alamo. It'll help you understand the trouble you run into when you get to the Rio Grande.
Andy saw two women pull a buggy up near the general store.
Well, that's Bethel Brackett and her mother.
I know. Give me a minute, Tom.
Take all the time you want. If it was me and I was 30 years younger, I'd take the whole morning.
Reaching the wagon, Andy dismounted.
Morning, Mrs. Brackett. Bethel?
He then extended his hand to help the older woman down.
We had no idea you were in town, Andy.
Passing through on duty. You're looking well, Mrs. Brackett.
He turned toward the younger woman who had been driving the horses. Bethel seemed reluctant at first to accept his help.
Annie Pickard, I ought not to speak to you.
What did I do?
It's what you don't do. You don't ever come to see a girl. You could be dead, and I wouldn't know about it for 6 months.
If I ever die, I'll write you a letter and let you know.
You could have let me know you were here.
Didn't get in till late yesterday. Can't stay. I've got orders to report to Austin.
Even my brother Farley breaks down and sends us a few lines every 6 months or so. I'd write to you if I knew where you'd be.
Half the time, I don't know that myself.
If you run into my brother somewhere, tell him Mother and I are all right.
She went inside the store, leaving Andy embarrassed and not knowing what to do about it. Tom had watched quietly. He drew in beside Andy.
That little girl thinks a lot of you.
Hard to tell it the way she acts.
A woman likes to have some attention paid to her, and you ain't done it. She'd follow you in a minute if you just asked her.
Follow me to what? A tent camp in the brush with a ranger company? She was raised better than that.
You won't be a ranger forever. Sooner or later, you'll get a belly full of cold camps and short rations. You'll start looking for a place to light.
I don't know as I could ever be a farmer like Rusty. Following a mule down a corn row is too slow a life for me.
Lots of rangers go in for sheriffing when they get tired of the service. They can uphold the law and still sleep in a decent bed most nights. If you was to decide to give it a try, I'd hire you as my deputy.
Much obliged, Tom, but so far I'm satisfied with what I'm doing.
A former slave, Chanty York, had inherited a small farm when his owner died. At first he had trouble keeping it because some neighbors objected to a black man's being a landowner. Several of them burned his cabin one night. Rusty and Tom and other friends rebuilt it, and none too gently elevated Chanty's antagonists to a higher level of tolerance. The old man looked frail. Nevertheless, he was working in his garden when Andy and Tom rode up. Chanty took off an unraveling old straw hat and wiped a tattered sleeve across a black face shining with sweat. His broad smile displayed a solid row of white teeth. So far as Andy knew, he still had all the ones God had given him.
Mr. Tom, Andy, you all get down and grab hold of this hoe for a while.
Chanty had known Andy since the day Rusty had brought him home, a hurt and frightened boy who spoke only Comanche. Chanty had helped care for Andy's broken leg and patiently coached him word by word into remembering his forgotten English.
Morning, Chanty! Andy, keep safe and remember what I told you.
Tom rode on toward his own farm.
You stay and eat with me, won't you, Andy?
I wish I could, but I've got orders. Just want to drop by and see Rusty before I go.
Oh, you don't need to worry none about Mr. Rusty. He's doing fine, him and Miss Alice. I don't know as they've told anybody yet, but she's in a family way.
Oh, the old rusty-haired son of a gun. I didn't know he still had it in him.
It's in Miss Alice now. She glows like the sunrise.
Anything I can send you from Mexico, Chanty?
Any necessaries I can get right here to home. Can't think of nothing I'd want from way off yonder.
Rio Grande is pretty far, all right.
Oh, too far for these weary old bones. And now you be careful you don't come back speaking Mexican. Took us long enough to get you over speaking Comanche.
Andy reached into his saddlebag and lifted out a small sack.
Brought you some rock candy to sweeten your disposition.
I thank you mighty kindly.
Would you like me to milk your cow for you before I go?
Oh, she dried up for a little while. She's in a family way, too. Now, you be careful, boy. They tell me there's lots of wicked goings-on down along that river.
There's wicked goings-on everywhere.
Andy turned once in the saddle to wave at Chanty, then reined the black horse in the direction of Rusty Shannon's farm. The familiar terrain brought back memories, most of them pleasant. A few he didn't want to dwell upon. Not far from here, he had been part of an unlucky Comanche raiding party, come down from the high plains to steal horses. In a skirmish with rangers and settlers, his horse had fallen on him. Rusty had recognized that he was white and took him to his farm to heal. At first, Andy had given him reason to regret his generosity, trying to escape back to his Comanche friends. He had eventually realized that the Indians had reached the end of their time as free-roaming horsemen of the plains. He had gradually accepted his place in the white world, though sometimes he still found himself thinking like a Comanche, feeling like a Comanche. He leaned heavily upon instincts that were sometimes so strong they puzzled him. Riding by Rusty's field, he saw that the corn was tall and green, promising a good yield. Alice stood in the cabin's open dog run, slicing a ham suspended from a rafter. She didn't see him right away. She was a slender woman with light brown hair almost to her waist. He had always considered her handsome, though her sister Josie might have been prettier. Josie's death had dealt Rusty a blow that for a time threatened to break his spirit. Eventually, he had worked his way up from the darkness and had come to accept Alice. Andy had been pleased, though he had one reservation. He feared Rusty might regard her as second best, a substitute, that Josie still held first place in his heart. Alice deserved better than that.
Andy! Oh!
She gave Andy a sisterly hug, then pushed him off at arm's length to look him over.
Don't the Rangers ever feed you? You look like you haven't eaten in a month.
I eat Indian style. When I can get it, I eat all I can hold. When I can't get it, I live off of what I ate before.
I'll slice some more ham and see how much you can eat for supper. I've managed to put some weight on Rusty. If you stay around a week or so, I'll fatten you up too.
Can't. I've been ordered to Austin.
Oh, a few days of company would be good for Rusty. He hasn't been away from the farm much since planting time.
I guess he figures he did enough traveling when he was a ranger. A man can get awful tired of it.
Oh, don't you get tired of it, Andy?
Now and then, but as soon as I rest up a little, I'm ready to go again.
There'll come a day when you'll decide it's been enough, like Rusty did. You'll want to settle down. Are you going to go see Bethel Brackett before you leave?
Already saw her, in town. Where's Rusty?
He went looking for a heifer. He thinks she's had her calf and she's hiding it out.
Summer calves can be hard to raise.
A farmer is ready to take rain or a calf anytime.
She went into the kitchen side of the cabin.
I'll start supper when I see Rusty come to the barn. How about some coffee while you wait?
I can get it myself.
Rusty had done his bachelor cooking at the fireplace, but Andy noted that a new iron stove had been installed. A shop-made table and sturdy wooden chairs replaced the crude homemade kitchen furniture that he remembered. He watched Alice, trying to discern a sign of her pregnancy. All he saw was a brightness he hadn't found in her eyes before.
Shaddy tells me there'll be three of you by and by.
Oh, how could he know? We haven't told anybody.
Guess he saw it for himself. He said you glow like the sunrise. I believe he was right.
I've reason enough. I'm happy here. I couldn't ask for things to be any better.
Andy looked at the mantle. Always before, he'd seen a picture of Josie there. It was gone now. Alice turned to see where his gaze was directed.
Looking for Josie's picture. Rusty took it down. He said he didn't need a picture to remember or to keep pushing the past into his face. Said yesterday's gone. Today's all we've got.
You think he really sees it that way?
Sometimes when he holds me, I can't help feeling that he's thinking of Josie. I've tried real hard to be a good wife to him. Lord knows he deserves it. I wouldn't ask him to forget Josie ever. But maybe with time, I can be as much a part of him as she ever was. Even more.
Maybe you already are.
No, not yet. But I will be. I'm a Monahan, and you've never seen a Monahan give up.
Andy walked to the door and saw that Rusty had ridden up to the log barn.
I'm going to see if Rusty needs any help.
Tell him supper will be ready by the time he gets through with the milk in.
As he walked toward the barn, Andy remembered that it had been only a few months since he had ridden by here on his way to an assignment, and he and Rusty had exchanged small talk about crops and rain and local politics. Andy squinted, comparing Rusty's present appearance with the last time.
I see a little bit more gray in your hair.
Well, you've got the sun in your eyes.
Alice looks fine.
She does, doesn't she?
You'll be needing all the milk old Bossy can give. I understand you all are expecting.
Alice told you?
Shanty did. That old man sees things nobody else can.
He ought to. He's been around since the Colorado River was just a creek. What brings you over this way?
I've been reassigned to a company on the Rio Grande.
A man can get himself killed down there.
A little risk never stopped you.
It would now. I've got responsibilities.
I don't.
You've got a responsibility to yourself. If you stay too long, you're liable to get all shot up and have to quit anyway. Then you may be too crippled to do much of anything else.
I'm doing a job that needs to be done. When I stop feeling that way, I'll turn it back to them like you did.
As cities went, Andy always found Austin agreeable, provided he didn't stay too long. His first visit there had been with Rusty and Tom Blessing. He had spent his early years in Indian villages, and later in the sparse farming community where Rusty lived. The size of this city had amazed him. It was the state capital, Texas's seat of power. That fact had been driven home to him by a tempest that boiled up in 1873 upon the transfer of the governorship from the state's Reconstruction Administration back to the Texans who had supported the Confederacy. Many former Rangers cast adrift after the war had participated in the forcible removal of a reluctant Unionist governor. The place looked peaceable now after several years of stable and generally benevolent government. Andy had ridden up Congress Avenue toward the Capitol building. The street was wide enough that several spans of mules or oxen could turn a wagon around without crunching its wheels against the wooden sidewalks. After seeing the town several times, Andy was still in awe of the wagon and carriage and horseback traffic and the busy-looking pedestrians along the street. He paused in apprehension at the door of the Ranger's state office, wondering what was in store for him. Straightening his back, he stepped inside. A clerk sitting at a roll-top desk turned and viewed him over the rims of reading glasses set low on his nose.
Yes?
I'm Private Andy Pickard. I was ordered to report here for reassignment.
The clerk did not recognize the name. His face was pale, the mark of a man who spent his days in an office rather than out in a field.
Oh, yes, Pickard. Do you know Major Jones?
Met him. He's visited camps where I've been.
Major John Jones was well known for spending a minimum of time in the office. He was usually on the trail in his buggy, inspecting the far-flung ranger outposts that were his responsibility.
Luckily, you have chosen a day when the Major is in. Unfortunately, at this moment, he has company. You may sit if you choose to wait.
Andy seated himself in an uncomfortable, straight-backed wooden chair that he supposed was meant to discourage long visits.
But it's not gonna work. It's a waste to have so many men. You know that.
And you know being so stingy is liable to get more of them killed.
Andy glanced at the clerk, asking a silent question. The clerk rolled his eyes.
The Major is having a discussion with a representative of the treasurer's office. The gentleman is explaining why the Rangers must do more, but do it with less money and fewer men.
A man as pale-faced as the clerk strode out of Jones's office.
If it were up to me, we would disband the Rangers. That would stop this needless drain on the state's resources.
And I hope the next person to face a hold-up man is yourself, sir. I'd like to see how long it would take you to call for the Rangers.
Major Jones's fists were clenched when he turned to the clerk.
There goes a man who can make me forget the biblical injunctions against profanity.
As his anger subsided, he became aware of Andy standing at attention.
I remember your face, but your name's a puzzle to me.
Private Andy Pickard, sir? I was ordered to report to you for a reassignment.
Oh, yes.
The clerk handed Jones a couple of sheets of paper. Jones glanced at them.
Come in.
The Major was a small man, but he had a firm handshake and a strong, steady gaze that seemed to see into the hidden part of a man's mind.
Have a seat, Pickard. As you may know, the legislature has seen fit to cut our budget again. Some from the settled parts of the state say we don't need Rangers now that the Army has the Comanches and other hostiles safely tucked away on their reservations. I've argued to little avail that outlaws present as much of a challenge now as the Indians ever did. Would you not agree?
Yes, sir.
I'm keeping as many Rangers as I can, given the funds the state has allotted to me. Your record tells me you are one whose services I should retain. I'm transferring you to a region that needs all the law enforcement it can get. You familiar with the Nueces Strip?
I've heard of it. Never been there.
It's the region between the Nueces River and the Rio Grande. Mexico still claims it, in spite of the treaty Sam Houston won from Santa Ana. The scarcity of laws made it a gathering ground for robbers and cutthroats from both countries.
I heard Captain McNally whipped them a few years ago.
Leander McNally and his men put down much of the worst trouble, but fighting still goes on. Mostly it's between the races. White against Mexican, Mexican against white. How do you get along with Mexicans?
All right, I guess. Never knew very many. They haven't settled much where I come from.
Mexicans dominate the Nueces Strip, at least in numbers. Some still consider themselves to be living in Mexico and not subject to American law. At the same time, many Americans in that section don't recognize that Mexicans have legitimate rights, especially ownership of property. They drive them from their lands, or try to. They'd like to see every Mexican banished to Mexico or killed. It's not for us to choose sides. It's our responsibility to put down violence from whatever quarter it may arise.
Sounds like that would take a lot of rangers.
Far more than we have, which sometimes drives us to actions we wouldn't normally consider. Captain McNally used extreme measures, but the situation called for them. He was up against desperate men.
What do you mean, extreme measures?
At the worst, summary executions. We would prefer to observe all the niceties of the law, but outlaws respect only force. McNally knew how to get their attention. He stacked the bodies of a dozen dead bandits in the town square in Brownsville. Afterward, he conducted a raid across the river into Mexico and shot every suspect he came across. No doubt he killed some who didn't deserve it. They were simply in the wrong place at the wrong time. This caused us no end of diplomatic trouble. It's easy to criticize him now from the comfort of an Austin office, but you have to give him credit. He put a damper on border jumping for a while.
It's been preached to me over and over that everybody has a right to be tried by a jury.
No bandit summons a jury before he shoots someone. Mind you, I do not advocate summary justice. However, under extreme circumstances, we may have little choice. Now, after what I've told you, you think you can handle this assignment?
I'll do my duty as I see it, sir.
Your commanding officer may sometimes see it differently than you do. If so, will you obey him?
If I can't, I'll give him my resignation.
Well enough. But surely, you would not desert him in a crisis.
I won't quit in a fight, but I might resign afterward.
Jones dipped a pen in an inkwell and began to write an order.
How soon can you start?
Right now. I'm traveling light.
It's a long way to ride alone. I have assigned another ranger of your acquaintance to the same place. Find him and you can travel together. His name is Farley Brackett.
Hearing that name was like biting into a sour apple. Andy and Farley had ridden together on several missions, but their relationship had always been prickly.
From all I know of him, Brackett's a good man to have at your side in a fight.
Andy knew that to be true, but was tempted to tell Jones that Farley started some of those fights himself. The war had left a visible scar on his face and invisible scars on his soul. In the first years after the Confederate defeat, he had been an unreconstructed rebel, a constant thorn in the side of Union authorities. He had brought trouble to Rusty Shannon's door, and therefore to Andy as well. The Major handed Andy the order he had been writing.
Stop at Ranger headquarters in San Antonio as you pass through. They can tell you exactly how to find your camp on the Rio Grande. It moves from time to time.
Yes, sir.
Andy sensed that the Major was finished with him. He thought he should salute or something, but he simply backed to the door. The clerk was waiting for him.
I hope you've got a little money.
A little? Not much.
Well, it'll have to stretch. Now, we have no traveling money to give you.
I don't eat much.
Well, that's good. You may have to live off the land.
Any idea where I'll find Farley Brackett?
He put his horse in a stable down the street. Beyond that, I suggest you investigate all the dram shops.
Brackett did not have a reputation as a drinking man, but perhaps that was because he seldom had the opportunity. Whiling away the hours in Austin might tempt him to make up for time lost in dry and Spartan ranger camps. Andy went to a livery barn where he and Rusty and Tom Blessing had stabled their horses on a visit several years ago. He recognized the proprietor as the same dried-up little man who had been there before, charging a shameless price for oats, hay, and corral space.
I'm looking for a ranger named Farley Brackett.
The hostler pointed to a stall.
Well, his horse is here. I doubt Brackett's gone far afoot. Most of the rangers I know would rather be whipped with a wet rope than walk 100 yards.
If he comes in, tell him Andy Pickard is looking for him.
Andy Pickard? You've gotten some older, but I believe I remember you. Ain't you the one that spiked them Union soldier boys' cannon so they couldn't use it to keep that Yankee-fied governor in office?
I didn't spike the cannon, but I was with the ones that did.
Well, it was a hell of a show for a little while. Too bad it fizzled out before anybody got a chance to kill one of them damn Yankees.
Like many Texans, the hostler was still engaged in the war between the states, at least with words. Living among the Comanches at the time, Andy had been only dimly aware of the war. He knew a lot about its aftermath, however. To some degree, it was still going on, just as the war between Texas and Mexico continued along the border years after it had been relegated to the past elsewhere. He walked back over to Congress Avenue and toward the first saloon he saw.
I don't give a damn whether you like Rangers or not.
Suddenly a man flew through the open door. Farley Brackett stood in the doorway.
Come back in and I'll finish winding your clock for you.
The man sat up, but for the moment looked too confused to continue the contest. Farley's eyes recognized Andy.
Badger Boy? What the hell you doing here?
Badger Boy was an English version of the name by which Andy had been known among the Comanches. No one used it anymore, except Farley.
Looking for you? I ought to have known to wait and listen for a fight.
Wasn't no fight to it. I was just standing there having me a peaceful drink when that gink asked me if I wasn't a ranger. Don't know how he figured out I was. They never have gotten around to giving us any badges.
Some people claim they can tell a ranger on sight just by the way he walks and talks.
I wasn't talking at all till that bird started to hurrah me. Said he'd never seen a ranger that didn't smell like a skunk.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.